Hello, everyone. Happy Wednesday. We are here today to celebrate our sharks and discuss our upcoming expedition. So I'm Paige Finney, OCEARCH's communications specialist, and I'm joined with OCEARCH founder and expedition leader, Chris Fischer, and OCEARCH chief scientist, Dr. Bob Hueter. So thank you for all joining us today on your lunch hour. Really want to just hop right in here and get started with you, Chris. If you can tell us a little bit more about when you learned that the shark populations were declining and that you needed to do something about it, and what that something was OCEARCH. So can you tell us that story a little bit?
Sure. First, I want to give a shout out to everybody who's leaving comments from over in Deutschland and Vancouver and Raleigh, Santa Barbara, and the Carolinas. This Daytona Beach, awesome. Hi to everybody, Florida. Super stoked to see so many. Prince Edward Island, I'm jealous. So great to see people from all over the world chiming in. How y'all doing down in New Orleans and up in Canada? So really great. This whole thing, Cape Cod, where it began on the East Coast. So this whole thing began. We were working on the water. Brett and I were working on the water from the late 90s into the early 2000s. And we were helping scientists study other species that we enjoyed catching, which was a lot of things like billfish, you know, different species, black marlin, blue marlin, sailfish. And we saw that we could make, I got to give a shout out to Turkey, Cape Breton, Pennsylvania. We saw that we could really have this tremendous synergy when we brought the practical knowledge of full-time watermen together with the scientists and the academic community, so that we had the right people and the right boats to go out and gather as much information about whatever we were studying as possible. And in the past, there hadn't been a lot of good collaboration or maybe an enterprise set up to create enough collaboration to really help these scientists get their hands on what they study, right? If they can get their hands on it, they can leverage modern technology, and then they can collect the data that they need to solve the puzzle of those animals' lives so we can manage them back, you know, help them where they mate, help the babies where they're born in the nursery and so forth. So while we were helping these scientists study other things, Bob can talk more in depth about this. A paper was published around 2007 or so that said our big sharks were in real big trouble across the globe, that we were down to 9% of our big sharks. And the scientists then, you know, I think we're going to talk about a little bit later and Bob can go in more in depth. The scientists said, you know, hey, if we don't have a good, healthy population of our large sharks, then we're going to struggle with our fisheries for our kids and food for the future. And also a functioning ocean, because these big sharks kind of are the system managers. So the reason that was is because the animals were so big and they were the system manager, and we hadn't had a situation where the right practical knowledge, you know, full-time watermen had come together with the right academic team around the right capacity, like the ship with this unique lift. And so there was no real progress being made of a substantial level in the space to help these large sharks come back. You know, I had just had a couple, I was having kids and my relationship on the ocean was really changing. You know, in the early years we were into catching big fish, and then you start having kids and you want to catch them fish. And then you start thinking about, man, are these guys going to be able to catch fish with their kids and enjoy an ocean full fish and free dive? And so I was changing a lot. I was growing a lot. You know, it really happens when you have kids. It changes how you think about life. And so I thought, man, we can do, maybe this is an opportunity for us to do more. Maybe this is an opportunity for us to help where there's a real problem. And these scientists are saying, if we can get these big sharks coming back, we need to collect the data to do so. But if we do that, you know, there's 9 white shark populations around the world. If we understood them all and we understood where they were mating and birthing and nurseries and all the parts of their life history, we could manage those populations back, which would ensure those regions have a lot of fish for future generations. So there's 9 puzzles. And I said, well, maybe if we can attack these puzzles one at a time and solve them, what a gift that would be to leave to the future. So we just changed our whole lives, and we pivoted to science and exploration to really try to do something great for our kids. That's how it started. There was no angle. The angle was like fish sandwiches for our grandkids.
That's great. Thank you, Chris, for just giving that background for anyone who doesn't know that from OCEARCH. Bob, can you get a little bit about your background and kind of how you got into shark research?
Well, Chris, you and I had our first conversation together. I think it was in 2010. It was when Deepwater Horizon had blown up in the Gulf, the oil blowout. And I guess the rest has been history since then. So we've been together since then for 12, 13 years. My story actually starts back as far back as the 1970s when I was at the University of Miami. And I knew I wanted to be a marine scientist. I had the heart of a human, but the brain of a scientist. I kind of figured that out early as a young boy. Loved Florida, loved the ocean, and started studying the sea and discovered how fantastic sharks are, how well adapted they are. The fact that they've been on this planet for 400 million years. We know that through the fossil record. And there's more than 500 species of sharks now in the oceans. Studied sharks at the University of Miami under a brilliant guy named Samuel Gruber, and began my career at Moat Marine Laboratory as a shark scientist, eventually gravitating more toward the conservation side, because as I was working with sharks and working out on the water and working with fishermen, it became clear by the late 1980s that something was going wrong in our shark population. They were getting harder to find. Species were dropping out from certain areas. And we began this long process of first collecting the data that's necessary to know what was happening, and then beginning to educate both the public and also policymakers about what needed to be done. So when Chris called me in 2010 and offered to bring his ship over from the Pacific side to the Gulf and start working on sharks on the Atlantic coast, I jumped at the offer. And we worked together as essentially as I was sort of running a single project or a single group of projects. And since then, we've greatly diversified with this incredible staff. We have Harley Newton, our chief veterinarian. We have John Tominski, our senior data scientist. So now we have a full-fledged scientific resident staff in OCEARCH. And it's all thanks to Chris and his ship and Brett and his expertise in getting us these sharks.
Great. Thank you for that background, Bob. Now let's get into a little bit about the sharks themselves. So we kind of learned about how you guys both got into sharks, but why are sharks so important? Why are sharks the answer to creating this balanced and abundant ocean?
Bob, I'll leave it to you to give the 1 minute summary of why that happens.
And then I'll throw it back to you for cleanup, because you always seem to be able to put it in such a great way. Let's be clear. Sharks aren't the only thing in the ocean, but they are a keystone group of animals, and they occupy a very important part of ocean ecosystems in that they are mostly top predators. And just like on the land with food webs on the land, with the top predators being necessary to keep everything in balance below them, the sharks play that role in the oceans. And we've found that through this era, beginning around the 1960s through at least the 1990s, as sharks were wiped out, essentially depleted and to numbers less than 25% of what they had been before, and in some habitats like coral reefs completely removed, we've soon discovered the deleterious effect of that on the ecosystem. Species out of balance, whole habitats dying. Coral reefs die when you remove the sharks from the reef because of the cascading effects of the sharks not being there, and the problems that starts. So now we know that sharks are critically important, and we focus on them because if we can bring them back, if we can get their numbers back into the proper sort of abundance, then we know that the ocean is coming back with them, because they need, you know, they need fairly decent habitat and lots of space and lots of food. And this is the exciting part of the era we now live in, especially working with the OCEARCH team and working on the white shark of the Western North Atlantic. This is a stock, this is a population that is coming back. Yay, finally, not just gloom and doom, but we're finally seeing success. And So the research that we're doing is helping to assure that success. It's identifying the critical habitats where these animals live and what they need. And so our brand and our focus is sharks, but really our heart and our whole program is about the ocean and the planet beyond that, because without a healthy ocean, we don't have a healthy planet. So, all right, Chris, now you can put it much more tightly in a way that everybody loves. Chris, you're muted, buddy. You're muted.
I think it's so interesting when you think about the shark, you know, roaming through the ocean, like you think about a wolf roaming through Yellowstone or a lion roaming across the Serengeti. You know, they're affecting everything as they move around, right? It's like everything is like, oh, God, there's the lion. I better go hide. Oh, I need to, you know, stay out of the way, right? So just them moving through is affecting everything. The birds are chirping. The other animals are hearing that. They're fleeing, right? So these large apex predators like white sharks, you know, they do eat seals, and that prevents seals, that particular seal, from eating more fish and stuff and wiping out our fish stocks. But that one white shark moving up and down the beach like a lion moving through the wildebeest, right? It affects the behavior of every seal. So they don't go out in the ocean and eat as much. So our fish stocks thrive. So the really interesting thing, I think, in the evolution from the, you know, wiping them out from the 60s to the 90s and then starting to protect them in the 90s and now 30 years later having real traction and a recovery, is that as they move around, they affect everything, which then allows things to be in balance. So there's a maximum amount of fish for the future and life for the future. So I think that's the one thing people need to understand. When you think about it that way, you're like, oh my gosh, the white sharks, they're guarding our fish stocks. They are all of the sharks. They're the guardians of our fish stocks that we need to thrive to eat. And if they're not there, these other things like seals and squid are going to wipe out the fish and the fry, and then we're not going to have anything to eat. So like what a turn of theme for the white shark, right? The great man eater. We should be terrified, right? All coming from, you know, the fear of the unknown, you know, really leveraged in the 70s by Jaws. But now, since we've put data around their lives, there is no more unknown. We understand their lives now. The life of the white shark is no longer a great mystery off the East Coast of the United States. It demystified the animal. People fell in love with the animals as they cruised around. And now people are starting to understand, oh, wow, I need to be loving up on these white sharks the same way we love up on a lion in the Serengeti or a wolf in Yellowstone, because the path to abundance goes through them, because they guard our fish stocks.
Perfect. And now you both mentioned the population off the East Coast of the United States, and that is the population around the world that OCEARCH is currently solving, the Western North Atlantic White Shark Study. So let's talk a little bit about our work in this area and the 88 sharks that we've tagged in this area.
Well, you know, we started out wanting to know not only what the status of the shark is off the East Coast of the United States, but also the trends and its whole life history, essentially from birth to death. And there was spotty information before we started our work that came primarily through fisheries interactions and, you know, caught sharks, essentially, that were landed. But the whole intricacies of the cycle and the range of the animals and their reproductive cycles and things like that were still pretty mysterious. Now we find ourselves, and we started our work in 2012, but we really started digging in here on this coast around, what, Chris, 2016 or 2017 or so.
Yeah.
So this has been about a six-year long program at this point, with a couple of expeditions left. And we pretty much have all the pieces of the puzzle assembled so that we know where the animals are born, where they spend their first summer of life, and confirm that the nursery area is, in fact, off of Long Island and that part of the Mid-Atlantic, how far they go when they migrate in the fall. We now know that they use the Eastern Gulf of Mexico actually quite a bit. About half of the group comes into the Eastern Gulf. I think the, probably the most exciting development that we showed was how many of these animals go past the known places where they were, like Cape Cod, and go to Canada, and how important Atlantic Canada is to this stock. So it's really not a U.S. stock. It's a shared stock with Canada, and even with, to some extent, with nations to the south, Mexico and Cuba and parts of the Caribbean. And then finally, we're seeing what these big mature females are doing, and that they're making these long transits offshore. We thought at one time they might go to Europe, but those animals only went out about halfway and came back. So this has been very revealing. I think we have a tendency now to, since we've talked about this so much, that people think we always knew this. No, we didn't. Not until we started our work.
I think it's amazing when you think back when we tagged the first animals, Mary Lee and Catherine, back in 2012 and 13. Nobody knew where they were going to go. I mean, I remember being on the ship and being and people were guessing, where do you think they were going to go? I remember Greg guessed, he said, they're going to go live in the Sargasso Sea. That was his guess. And we were all just guessing. And lo and behold, the things just cruised down the beach and we're all living with them all the time. And, you know, what had happened was I had gotten really frustrated. We'd move the ship around the world and we'd help these groups of scientists, but we didn't stay long enough to finish the projects. So, you know, if scientists needed, you know, 80 sharks or something, we'd go get them started and get them their first 20 or their first 40. And then we'd have to move the ship to go help someone else. And we had all these projects kind of half finished. So when we came back from, we did tag those couple fish like Catherine and Mary Lee in 12 and 13, which took us down to Florida and along the East Coast. We went around the world and did these other expeditions. And finally, when I came back and I was talking to Bob, I'm like, okay, Bob, how many sharks do you need to finish? We need to finish, because if we don't finish and we don't get peer-reviewed papers, we got nothing to leverage. Helping scientists and getting half-done projects doesn't matter, because if you move the ship, it costs a fortune to move the ship back to that region of the world. So I was like, we're going to hunker down here off the East Coast of the United States. How many sharks do you need, Bob? He got together with his collaborators and his team, and they came back and they said 60 sharks. And it was, you know, males and females, like 20 mature, 20, you know, juvenile, and 20 young of the year, you know, 10 males, 10 females. So we start doing that work, right? And we catch Mary Lee and Catherine, and they lead us down to the southeastern United States, and we're fishing down in the southeastern United States. All of a sudden, we catch this shark named Hilton, and Hilton goes to Canada. And he goes straight to Canada, bypasses the entire eastern seaboard of the United States. And it's like, oh, wow, there's a whole nother population of white sharks that is, you know, intermingled here, but not necessarily leveraging the northeastern United States, which everyone thought was kind of the center of the universe for white sharks in the Atlantic, which I think it's not. So then once we figured that out, I remember when we took our first expedition. Several of these first expeditions that we've had, the first expedition to Canada, people like, there's not hardly any white sharks. You're never going to find white sharks up there. You know, and we've tagged 34 white sharks up there. When Mary Lee led us into the New York, New Jersey bite in the spring and early summer, and we're like, that looks like a birthing run based on some of our work over in the Pacific. And then I mentioned it to Bob, and then Bob came back and said, oh man, there's this legendary paper from this guy named Jack Casey back in the 80s who caught a long line set of small white sharks. So there's some sort of suspicion that a white shark thing is going down in the region. But when we said we were going up, people were like, there's no white sharks up here, you know, and we went up there and we found 20 babies, young of the year. So we found the baby white shark. So
right off the beach.
So it's just been amazing to start with 60. And then Bob's like, oh, Canada, we need 100 white sharks now to solve this puzzle, to answer all these questions. And at the time, it seemed impossible, you know, but right now we're on shark 88. Right. So we're just down to the short strokes on very specific animals to finish very specific projects, which makes the angling challenge more difficult because it's got to be in a certain time of the year and a certain, you know, certain, you know, maturity levels and so forth, so it complicates things. But it's been amazing to watch it develop now, because like we always guess, where are they mating? Where's the birthing site and this, that, and the other. And I can tell you, I was so sure I knew when we started, and I was so wrong. I was wrong from the very beginning, and understand now why, and what a great experience to go through learning and having to change the whole map of what's going on in your head, and then how other parts of it more seamlessly fall together. So it's been like this project off the East Coast has been amazing. You know, it's taken, like Bob said, maybe like 6 years, 7 years of expeditioning, which is about, you know, for everybody, about $14 million in expeditions. It's about $2 million a year to give the ship to the scientists. Which is actually really fast and really cheap to solve a puzzle of this importance for this region. Then they'll be able to leverage this data forever. It'll be the benchmark for climate change data on the movement of the white sharks, because we've now established the range at this time, which there was nothing for us to compare to. So it's cool. You know, it can be done. You can solve the full life history of a population of white sharks. And people said many years ago that would never be done. And now we're about to wrap it up. And it's a model, like you said, this is just one of the 9 white shark populations around the world. Some of those populations have people studying the sharks in them, and they have several pieces of the puzzle, or different people in the region have different pieces of the puzzle. And, you know, if you can bring those people together, maybe with some capacity, we can quickly solve those in those regions. And then there's other regions of the world where there's nothing known, and you got to pioneer it from the beginning. And that's kind of what makes me excited and gets me really going, is the real pioneering of the unknown. So great to be wrapping this up and proving it's possible, but really excited that there's 8 more puzzles to go.
Yeah. So we've talked about the amazing journey over the last few years off the East Coast of the US and Atlantic Canada. And our next step in that journey, we just announced this Sunday that we are going to be going on Expedition Northbound on April 17th to May 4th. What are some of our goals for this upcoming expedition?
Well, Chris said we're up at shark number 88. We're trying to get to 100 by the end of this year with the end of this year with 2 expeditions left. We're at that stage where we're getting down to the really smart sharks are left out there, and it's hard, getting harder and harder to find them. And we're going in places where they're less concentrated. So off the Carolinas, we know they spend quite a bit of the winter and early spring. If you look on the tracker now, you'll see sharks pinging all the way from the Outer Banks of the Carolinas all the way down into the eastern Gulf of Mexico. But that area out there, we think, is where the large males and females may be coming together. The actual site and time of mating is our last piece of the puzzle that we want to drop into the board and then say we got the whole thing. So that's the goal of this particular trip, is to try to not so much quantity but quality, get the bigger animals, maybe see some signs of recent mating or getting ready to mate. And then also, by the way, there's, you know, you see on the tracker the movements and so on, but that's just the most visible part of what we do. We've got a whole group of 24, 25 projects that are looking at everything about these animals inside and out, including biomedical aspects of them for human medicine. So there's a lot more to it than just tagging and tracking sharks around. And that's part and parcel of our expedition that's coming up.
Yeah, so exciting times coming up in about 4 to 5 weeks. We'll be out on expedition. Now we're going to use the last 5 minutes to answer some of the questions that we've gotten through the live stream. So if you have any new questions, feel free to comment them now. But a question I saw earlier was, what challenges do our large sharks currently face? What would you say the top challenges that large sharks face were?
I can tell you that without question, and it's now been shown through peer-reviewed work, overfishing is completely the most important challenge that they're facing. Just fishing, being fished, and too many of them being removed. Virtually every population, every species of shark is threatened to some extent by overfishing. And then way down the list, maybe affecting 10% of shark species, is habitat destruction, habitat change, especially places like nursery areas where sharks need those areas for their young. And then climate change is even farther down. And finally, things like pollution. But it's overfishing is our number one problem around the world. Fortunately, here in the U.S. and Canada, we've gotten fishing levels under control and our sharks are coming back. But worldwide, it's still a really big problem.
Yeah, and I think, you know, it's the overfishing and issue of the sharks and stuff is different in different parts of the world for different things. I do believe that we're starting to see some sort of shift. You know, there was a lot of pressure on the sharks from finning for a number of years in the 90s and leading up into the 2000s. But I feel like we're getting a little bit of seeing that kind of demand drop a bit, right? Like we're less and less people are wanting shark fin soup. The young people in Asia typically aren't eating as much of it. But I think that there's also just people are catching them to eat them, especially in poor areas of the world where they're just trying to, you know, survive and thrive. So there's a lot of pressure on them. But when you look historically at what happened in the United States, you know, we were gill netting most of the East Coast of the United States. And in the early 90s and late 80s, they wanted to bring the recreational fishing economy back, removed the gill nets from, you know, Massachusetts and New York and the New Jersey Bight and down the coast and then down in Florida banned their gill nets. And then what we saw was the return of a lot of life. And what we found from our research, you know, is that New York, New Jersey Bight is where the white sharks are dropping off their pups. It's their primary nursery. And back in the day, we didn't know it, but we were gill netting basically the birthing site. And the babies were having to run the gauntlets of those gill nets. They were catching stripers and mackerel and everything else in. And over the course of the few months they would live there in the summer, I just don't think any of them made it, you know, to start migrating south, or very, very few. And so we were seeing no white sharks. And you see about 20 years later or so after we banned those gill nets of 2008, 2009, you start to see the white sharks showing up at Cape Cod again. And that's when by 2012, boom, we were up there and we tagged Mary Lee Catherine and the rest of the first five females. And we're witnessing now those sharks now being old enough to be sexually mature and have babies. So we're seeing more baby sharks, more sharks becoming mature. It takes them 20 years to become mature before they can even have babies. So once we start protecting them, it's going to take 20 years till one of them can start making babies. Well, it's been 30 years now. So we got more white sharks that are mature. We have more baby white sharks in the nurseries. And it's just because of great fishery management moves in the past. Still challenges in areas where there's no enforcement and management, but great stories and winning stories where there is, like off the East Coast and the West Coast of the United States. We're turning our oceans back into some of the great wild oceans in the world, better since our, you know, the 40s and 50s and so forth. So it's an exciting time off the East Coast.
Yeah, and then we'll wrap it up with this last question about the sharks in Florida. So a lot of people are asking about the sharks that are currently pinging in Florida. Can we talk about why they're in Florida this time of year?
Well, these sharks, even as just several years old, start to expand their range south in the wintertime from that area that Chris mentioned, the New York, New Jersey Bight area. And they come down to the coast and they go around Florida and are found on both sides of the peninsula. They're not all here. There's a lot that just stay up in the Carolinas, but there's a fair number that are here. And so pretty soon in the next month or so, you're going to see them leaving places like the Eastern Gulf of Mexico and beginning their trek north. I think something that we have to keep in mind is when you look at the tracker and you see the map of the state of Florida and you see this big round ping that represents the location of a given shark, you get sort of the impression it's pretty close to shore. But in fact, at least on the west coast of Florida, these sharks are well outside of 20 nautical miles, usually 50 to 100 nautical miles offshore. So they're not up on the beaches. On the east coast, on the other hand, all the way up and down the coast, we've seen a lot of our sharks kind of hug the coastline. Now, they're not necessarily in the surf zone, but they're hugging the coastline at times. And yet, very few incidents, almost no incidents between white sharks and people in that area in the wintertime. So just understand that are there, and it's a good yeah. thing. The oceans are coming back, but you know, as Chris said, the sharks affect the behavior of the whole system, and includes us. We got to be smart. We're part of that same system, so you got to be smart in how you use the oceans when these sharks are there.
Yeah, and generally speaking, to answer the question, we believe the animals are down there. Oh, they're just foraging in the wintertime, just feeding, making it through the winter, right? They go up north in the summer and fall, and they bulk up on seals, right? They put on a bunch of weight. So when it gets cold, they leave and slide down between North Carolina and wrap around Florida for the wintertime. And they don't, you know, they might get the odd dead whale, which they would forage on, but they're eating a lot of fish. You see them on big bait runs. You see them on big fish events, the red drum run, the black drum run. White sharks will be on that, even the menhaden runs. And so they're going from event to event foraging. And then we believe as the winter starts to conclude, you know, we're coming into the spring equinox. I believe things like the spring equinox are a huge trigger for the white sharks and the fall equinox. And then you have, of course, the summer solstice and the winter solstice. These animals are highly connected to the moon. They know exactly where they are. They know exactly what time of year it is, the date it is, and they repeat their patterns year over year. So as we see them living off Florida and foraging in the winter, as the winter starts to get deeper into the winter, we believe that they're starting to get in the mindset, if they're over 20 years old or so and sexually mature, that they're coming into this kind of time to mate, right? Early spring and spring mating is what we believe right now. And we believe that, you know, they start to push up into the northern part of their winter habitat. And we're wondering if they're focused there to mate prior to heading northbound. So I think they're, you know, they come into Florida fat from all the seals up north. They try to maintain through the winter like so many animals and birds that migrate. And then they're preparing to mate in the spring prior to going back to their summer foraging and feeding grounds. So that's kind of the general idea of what's going on without talking about much about the birthing area and how the nursery expands. But that's what we think is going on in Florida, just overwintering, prepping for the spring mate.
And let me just add that I know everybody out there, you guys are all big supporters of what we do, and we're so appreciative for that. And so we're kind of talking to the choir here, preaching to the choir. But for those people that are out there that think, well, what, you know, should we worry that we're going to get too many white sharks? They're going to come back. Nature doesn't work that way. The system will reset. It might take a while to equilibrate where you get everything in balance. But that's what we want to do, is get back into balance. And you never see too many wolves or too many lions over a long period of time. Maybe brief periods, but not over a long period of time. The system is resetting, and that's what we want for our kids and our grandkids and generations beyond.
Exactly. Well put, Bob. Thank you everyone for tuning in today. I wanted to let you guys all know that as we lead up to our 45th expedition, Expedition Northbound, we are going to do a weekly live stream every Wednesday, all on different topics. Today, we really deep dived into the importance of our sharks and the starting of OCEARCH. But next week, we will be joined by our crew to learn more about collecting the right tools and the team for the job. So learning more about our fishing techniques and practices and using the ship as a tool and what makes it so special. So thank you all for tuning in today. We hope you will join us next week. And if we didn't get your question answered, I know there's a lot that we couldn't go through. We will try to get them answered in our comments. So OCEARCH will go through and try to comment and answer as many as possible. And then right before we go, I know we were joined by Mrs. Jones' sixth grade class. So I wanted to thank you for having your class join us today. Everyone have a great rest of your week. And again, we'll hopefully get those questions answered for you soon. Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
See y'all.